So I would now present, like, let us go to a little bit of theory for us to understand what exactly is CVI, and hoping that we can detect these children and bring them to the early intervention specialist, or to we can help them by treating them much, much earlier. So why is CVI now becoming important? Because why is everyone talking about CVI? We find that in India, with improved management and survival of children affected by brain injury due to perinatal insult or other other metabolic disorders or trauma, it is becoming the cause of visual impairment in our population. And along with that, we find that even in a multiple disability with visual impairment, many of them are children with CVI. So if we have to make assessment, we have to manage such children, though it is a very challenging field, but we need to move forward. So what is it? It's basically a deficiency in the function of vision due to damage or malfunction of the visual pathways and visual centers in the brain, basically just those posterior to the lateral geniculate body. So it is a big umbrella which covers a range of visual processing difficulties. So now it is not only vision, as the ophthalmologists are taught that everything is 6-6 vision, but there's a lot into it more than vision of 6-6. So how do you differentiate it from ocular visual impairment? I would not go much into details of this, but the clue, the one pearl which I would like to say is, if your ocular findings do not explain the visual difficulties of the child's parents or the parents' concerns, please look out for CVI. If the response to your treating conditions, ocular conditions, are usually suboptimal, we find that the rest of the structures of the eye may be normal. They may be associated cataract or optic nerve abnormalities, but the vision response, the visual behavior is much more profound than what we see in during the ocular examination. There's a latency for the visual response. The visual attention span is poor. The difficulties in crowded places. So all these make it much more difficult to assess, and also much more difficult for the parents to understand what exactly is the problem. So this is because this is vision is not only what we see actually 6-6. It is like there are multiple stations in the brain, the occipital lobes, posterior parietal lobes, and the temporal lobes, where we see a clear picture in the occipital lobe. The colors are appreciated. Shades of gray of the contrast are appreciated and also helps us to have a wide view of things, which is the visual fields. And we find that if any of these factors are affected, and if there's a damage to the occipital lobe by some problem during the antenatal or perinatal or postnatal period, they have problems in inability to perceive colors, inability to appreciate objects with less contrast, and visual field effects. And just imagine how a child could function without these basic vision processing in place. So it will be so difficult for them to see a blackboard. Maybe I just see one side of the blackboard, or maybe I don't see my inferior field. I cannot walk properly because I'm not able to judge what is there, what I'm seeing below my below in the inferior field, or I'm seeing everything blurred. There's a contrast problem. So these are issues which the intervention specialist helps us to manage, because we will just be doing the assessments and we will be plotting the range of vision processing difficulty, and the intervention specialist then finds out, okay, this is the problem, this contrast is poor, or the color vision is a problem, how to help the parents, guide them to how to help the child manage these problems. So the posterior parietal lobes, it connects the occipital lobe with the posterior parietal cortex, and it tells us where we are. It helps us to guide the body movements. Like a simple thing, like in the OPD, we do Alia symbols, which we have made it just, a child has so much problems with just, putting the pieces in the right places. So this is how we assess. This child had very good vision, 6-9 vision with the glasses. And we found that, but he still had problems. He had a hemiparesis on the right side. He still had problems in just putting these simple objects into the right places. And imagine how would he be performing in school then. So these are the problems which parents come and tell us that what is happening with my child. Damage to the posterior parietal lobes also helps causes simultanagnosia. What it means that I see one object, I'm able to pay attention to only one object, but the surrounding objects if there is a lot of cluttering, if there's a lot of crowding, I'm not able to place my position in them, and I get confused. And we find that even the inferior field, like imagine climbing down the steps or walking on the road, how difficult it may be for the child if there is an inferior field effect. So now the Lear mailbox in the OPD can help you find out if there's optic ataxia. See, this child is able to orient the slot and turns the card appropriately to correct position before putting it into the slot. So this visual guidance of movement is called, when there is an impairment, it is called optic ataxia. And see, this child, there is no, the child cannot exactly position the card in the correct position. The temporal lobe, when it is affected, like it is like recognizing colors, shapes, objects, numbers, letters, facial expressions. So it's so important that if we have to recognize a person by the face, or we need to recognize objects or letters, numbers, I may even need to find my route to where I'm going. I may lose my route. So I want to go home or to want to go to any other places. I get confused in a crowd. So how do we help such children? So vision, as you know, like I can recognize the pencil there by the temporal cortex. Then I know that the frontal lobe chooses the pencil. And then the dorsal stream, that is it, the parietal occipital lobe, instructs me, okay, where to reach for the pencil, how far to reach, how to position my hands and fingers to grasp this pencil, and then the task is completed. So it's such a difficult process, and it's such a difficult thing, that process in the brain which is occurring, but we don't realize it because everything is for us very easy. So this task is what is difficult in a child with cerebral visual impairment. And this is what the therapist or the early intervention specialist helps the parents. They tell them, okay, this task is difficult. We will teach the child how to improve on this task, how to guide them to help them with this task. So the etiology is, we need to ask the birth history and all these parents what was the cause. Whether there was hypoxia, there was brain damage, there was infections or hypoglycemia, a simple thing which we found was more common in India, and seizure disorders. So you suspect in all children with unexplained bilaterally decreased vision. Are there acquired causes like a head injury, if there was a cardiac arrest, focal infection, epilepsy or encephalitis? So we find that when in the late second to third trimester, when they're affected because of hypoxia or ischemia, it causes periventricular leukomalacia, and at term it causes encephalomalacia. So in our study, we found that, which was published in the Journal of Pediatric Ophthalmology and Strabismus, we found that maternal hypertension was the most common cause. Even in our preterm study, we found that cerebral visual impairment was seen in 22.5% of children. So when we go to screen children with ROP for ROP screening, we inform the parents at there itself that please, these are children who are born preterm. They may be at 6 months or 4 to 6 months. They may have delayed milestones. If they have delayed milestone, please come to the pediatric center and come to us for checking the vision or assessing the vision. Because it might be missed. You may diagnose it maybe at 2 years because you do not feel in between that the milestones are not proper. 90.9% are eventful eventual period. So all this can be captured during our history taking. So global development delay was seen in 22.7% of children. So what are the red flags to detect? So we need to know the normal milestones. RBSK has given a nice manual, and these are distributed in all their centers. They have child development centers all over India. We need to distribute, and we need to make all of them aware that if a child has no eye contact, no social smile, no awareness of hands, there is squinting when you see it before the age of 6 months, not reaching out to any object, then there's a red flag that they need to show a pediatric ophthalmologist. If they're not recognizing faces at 7 to 9 months, they're not picking up objects from the floor, they're pointing at pictures, they do not respond to mother's gestures, and they do not follow simple things, or they do not walk steadily, they have trouble in climbing up and down stairs, they cannot eat without help. All these are important red flags that we should pick up and refer to the center. So this is how we can detect and what are the causes. So now we go to the next part of a course. Like when these children come, what are the ophthalmic manifestations we see? How do we assess them? So that is how we will guide our ophthalmologist And in assessing these children with CVI, with simple tools, we do not want big tools, but with simple tools, if we can help during this course, help some of the guide many of the ophthalmologists and how we can pick them up easily in the clinic and help these children.